So anyone who has got question, they can write down.
Anybody got anything to ask? Nobody?
Anybody has got any question, please ask.
So what is a mithya? What is mithya?
What is mithya?
False.
Yeah.
False.
False.
Yeah.
Mithya means fault.
False, false.
False.
I'm pro. What is adharma?
What is the question? What is fault or what is adharma or what?
Your question is what is adharma, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So his question is what is adharma?
Yes, sir.
But dharma first, you must know, huh? What is dharma?
Everything in Krishna consciousness and help to other Vaishnavas and help other people is dharma.
Dharma is Bhagavad Pranitaha.
Yeah.
And whatever is not in line with God, that is adharma.
Yeah, Prabhu.
Someone want to read?
Yeah, bro. Vidharma paradharmascha abhasha upamachalaha adharma sakhaha panchema dharmagno dharmavatyajet. There are five branches of irreligion, appropriately known as irreligion. Vidharma, religious principles for which one is unfit. Paradharma, pretentious religion. Abhasa, analogical religion. Upadharma, and cheating religion. Chaladharma. One who is aware of real religious life must abandon these five as irreligious. Any religious principles opposed to the principle of surrendering to the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, are to be considered religious principles of irregularity or cheating. And one who is actually interested in religion must give them up. One should simply follow the instructions of Krishna and surrender unto him. To do this, of course, one needs very good intelligence, which may be awakened after many, many births through good association with devotees and the practice of Krishna consciousness. Everything but the principle of religion recommended by Krishna, sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja, should be given up as religion. Dharma bhado vidharma syat paradharmo nyachoditaha upadharmastu pakhando dambhova shabdhabhik chala. Religious principles that obstruct one from following his own religion are called vidharma. Religious principles introduced by others are called paradharma. A new type of religion created by one who is falsely proud and who opposes the principles of Vedas is called upadharma. And interpretation of one's jugglery of words is called chaladharma. To create a new type of dharma has become fashionable in this age. So-called swamis and yogis support that One may follow any type of religious system according to one's choice, because all systems are ultimately the same. In Srimad Bhagavatam, however, such fashionable ideas are called Vidharma, because they go against one's own religious system. The real religious system is described by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja. The real religious system is that of surrender to the lotus feet of the Lord. In the sixth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, in connection with Ajamil's deliverance, Yamaraja says, dharmam tu shaksad bhagavat pranitam. 6.13.19. Real religion is that which is given by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, just as real law is that which is given by the government. No one can manufacture actual law at home, nor can one manufacture actual religion. Elsewhere, it is said, Sabai pumsam paro dharmo yato bhakti radokshaje. Bhagavatam 1.2.6. The real religious system is that which leads one to become a devotee of the Supreme Lord. Therefore, anything opposed to this religious system of progressive Krishna consciousness is called Vidharma, Paradharma, Upadharma or Chaladharma. Misinterpretation of Bhagavad Gita is Chaladharma. When Krishna directly says something and some rascal interprets it to mean something different, this is Chaladharma, a religious system of cheating, or Shabdabhit, a jugglery of words. One should be extremely careful to avoid these various types of cheating systems of religion. A pretentious religious system manufactured by one who willfully neglects the prescribed duties of his order of life is called abhasa, a dim reflection or false similarity. But if one performs the prescribed duties of his particular ashrama or varna, why are they not sufficient to mitigate all material distress? It is indicated here that everyone should strictly follow the principles of varna and ashrama as given in the Shastra. In the Vishnu Puran 389, it is said, Varnashrama charvata purushena parapuman Vishnu radharyate pantha nanyatat tosha karanam. One should focus upon the destination of progress, which is to become Krishna consciousness. This is the aim and end of all varnas and ashramas. However, if Vishnu is not worshipped, the followers of varnashrama institution manufacture some concocted god. Thus, it has now become fashionable for any rascal or fool to be elected god, and there are many missionaries who have concocted their own gods, giving up their relation with the real God. In Bhagavad Gita, it is clearly said that one worship the demigods has lost his intelligence. Nonetheless, we find that even an illiterate person who has lost all intelligence is elected God. And although he has a temple, it has meat-eating sannyasis, and many polluted activities go on there. This type of religious system, which misguides its poor followers, is strictly forbidden. Such pretentious religions should be stopped altogether. The religious system is that a Brahmana should actually become a Brahmana. He should not only take birth in the Brahmana family, but must also be qualified. Also, even if one is not born in a Brahmana family, but has Brahminical qualifications, he must be considered a Brahmana. By strictly following this system, one can be happy without extra endeavor. Swabhavo vihito dharma kasya nestha prashantaye. The real aim of life is to mitigate distress, and one can do this very easily by following the principles of Shastra.
So you see how all the cheating religion has been described. Yes.
Yes, Prabhu.
So now we are caught with all kind of cheating things. Therefore, it is said that we have to take shelter of the Lord. That's why the Bhagavatam have risen. The Srimad Bhagavatam,
completely rejecting all religious activities which are materially motivated, this Bhagavad Puran propounds the highest truth, which is understandable by those devotees who are fully pure in heart. The highest truth is reality distinguished from illusion for the welfare of all. Such truth uproots the threefold miseries. This beautiful Bhagavatam, compiled by the great sage Vyasadeva in his maturity, is sufficient in itself for God realization. What is the need of any other scripture? As soon as one attentively and submissively hears the message of Bhagavatam, by this culture of knowledge, the Supreme Lord is established within his heart.
So you see, this is real religion. The Bhagavad Puran. Yes or not?
Yes, Prabhu.
It is considered to be the mature fruit of the... this purport is very long. So why not read?
Religion includes four primary subjects, namely pious activities, economic development, satisfaction of the senses, and finally liberation from material bondage. Irreligious life is a barbarous condition. Indeed, human life begins when religion begins. Eating, sleeping, fearing, and mating are the four principles of animal life. These are common both to animals and to human beings. But religion is the extra function of the human being. Without religion, human life is no better than animal life. Therefore, in human societies, there is some form of religion which aims at self-realization and which makes a reference to the man's eternal relationship with God. In lower stages of human civilization, there is always competition to lord it over the material nature, or in other words, there is a continuous rivalry to satisfy the senses. Driven by such consciousness, man turns to religion. He thus performs pious activities or religious functions in order to gain something material. But if such material gains are obtainable in other ways, then so-called religion is neglected. This is the situation in modern civilization. Man is thriving economically, so at present he is not very interested in religion. Churches, mosques, and temples are now practically vacant. Men are more interested in factories, shops, and cinemas than in religious places which were erected by their forefathers. This practically proves that religion is performed for some economic gains. Economic gains are needed for sense gratification. Often when one is baffled in the pursuit of sense gratification, he takes to salvation and tries to become one with the Supreme Lord. Consequently, all these states are simply different types of sense gratification. In the Vedas, the above mentioned four activities are prescribed in the regulative way so that there will not be any undue competition for sense gratification. But Srimad Bhagavatam is transcendental to all these sense gratificatory activities. It is namely transcendental literature. It is purely transcendental literature which can be understood only by the pure devotees of the Lord, who are transcendental to competitive sense gratification. In the material world, there is keen competition between animal and animal, man and man, community and community, nation and nation. But the devotees of the Lord rise above such competitions. They do not compete with the materialist because they are on the path of back to Godhead, where life is eternal and blissful. Such transcendentalists are non-envious and pure in heart. In the material world, everyone is envious of everyone else, and therefore there is competition. But the transcendental devotees of the Lord are not only free from material envy, but are well-wishers to everyone. And they strive to establish the competition-less society with God in the center. The contemporary socialist conception of competition-less society is artificial because in the socialist state, there is competition for the post of dictator. From the point of view of the Vedas, or from the point of view of common human activities, sense gratification is the basis of material life. There are three paths mentioned in the Vedas. One involves fruitative activities to gain promotion to better planets. Another involves worshipping different demigods for promotion of planets of the demigods. And another involves realizing the absolute truth and his impersonal feature and becoming one with him. The impersonalist aspect of the absolute truth is not the highest. Above the impersonal feature is the Paramatma feature, and above this is the personal feature of the absolute truth or Bhagwan. Srimad Bhagavatam gives information about the absolute truth in his personal feature. It is therefore higher than impersonal speculations and the Jnanakanda division of the Vedas. What to speak of the Karmakanda division? Srimad Bhagavatam is even higher than the Upasana Kanda because it recommends the worship of Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Sri Krishna, the divine son of Vasudeva. The divine son of Vasudeva. In the Karma Kanda, there is competition to reach heavenly planets for better. For better sense gratification. Mm-hmm. And there is similar competition in the Jnana Kanda and the Upasana Kanda. The Srimad Bhagavatam is superior to all of these because it aims at the supreme truth, which is the substance or the root of all categories. From Srimad Bhagavatam, one can come to know the substance as well as the categories and substance in the absolute truth. All the categories. The substance in the absolute truth, the Supreme Lord, and all emanations are relative forms of energy. Nothing is apart from the substance, but at the same time, the energies are different from the substance. The conception is not contradictory. Srimad Bhagavatam explicitly promulgates this simultaneously one and different philosophy of the Vedanta Sutra, which begins with Janmadasya Sutra. This knowledge that the energy of the Lord is simultaneously one with and different from the Lord is an answer to the mental speculators' attempt to establish the energy as the absolute. When this knowledge is factually understood, one sees the conceptions of monoism and dualism to be imperfect. Development of this transcendental consciousness grounded in the conceptions of simultaneously one and different leads one immediately to the stage of freedom from the threefold miseries. The threefold miseries are those miseries which arise from the mind and body, those miseries inflicted by another living being, and those miseries arising from natural catastrophes over which one has no control. Srimad Bhagavatam begins with the surrender of the devotee onto the absolute person. The devotee is fully aware that he is one with the absolute and at the same time in the eternal position of servant to the absolute. In the material conception, one falsely thinks himself the lord of all he surveys, and therefore he is always troubled by the threefold miseries of life. But as soon as one comes to know his real position as transcendental servant, he at once becomes free from all miseries. As long as the living entity is trying to master material nature, there is no possibility of his becoming servant of the Supreme. Service to the Lord is rendered in pure consciousness of one's spiritual identity. By service, one is immediately freed from material encumbrances. Over and above, this Srimad Bhagavatam is a personal commentation on the Vedanta Sutra by Sri Vyasadeva. It was written in the maturity of his spiritual life through the mercy of Narada. Sri Vasudeva is the authorized incarnation of Narayana, the personality of Godhead. Therefore, there is no question as to his authority. He is the author of all Vedic literatures. Yet he recommends the study of Srimad Bhagavatam above all others. In other Puranas, there are different methods set forth by which one can worship the demigods. But in the Bhagavatam, only the Supreme Lord is mentioned. The Supreme Lord is the total body and the demigods are the different parts of that body. Consequently, one who worships the Supreme Lord does not need to worship the demigods because the Supreme Lord becomes fixed in the heart of the devotee immediately. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has recommended Srimad Bhagavatam as the spotless Purana and distinguished it from all other Puranas. The proper method for receiving this transcendental message is to hear it submissively. A challenging attitude cannot help one realize this transcendental message. One particular word is used herein for proper guidance. The word Shushrushu. One must be anxious to hear this transcendental message. The desire to sincerely hear is the first qualification. Less fortunate persons are not at all interested in hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. The process is simple, but the application is difficult. Unfortunate people find enough time to hear idle social and political conversations. But when invited to attend a meeting of devotees to hear Srimad Bhagavatam, they suddenly become reluctant or they indulge in hearing the portion of the Bhagavatam they are unfit to hear. Sometimes professional readers of the Bhagavatam immediately plunge into the confidential topics of the pastimes of the Supreme Lord, which they interpret as sex literature. Srimad Bhagavatam is meant to be heard from the beginning. Those who are fit to assimilate this work are mentioned in this sloka. One becomes qualified to hear Srimad Bhagavatam after many pious deeds. The intelligent person who thoughtful discretion can be assured by the great sage Vyasadeva that he can realize the Supreme Personality directly by hearing Srimad Bhagavatam without undergoing the different stages of realization set forth in the Vedas. One can be lifted immediately to the position of Paramahamsa simply by agreeing to receive this message.
So, in other words, if you are not Krishna conscious, then you are actually practicing adharma. That's why Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, no, give up all dharma. Sarva dharma parityaja mam ekam sharanam raja. Yes? So anything not related to Krishna is considered as, you know, cheating religion. Dharma projihita. Projihita means, comes from the word, you know, cheating. So in other words, religion means Krishna consciousness. That is the real explanation of that. That's why I also hear Krishna explain. Sarvasya ham hriti sanvisto mata smriti jnanam apohanam cha vedescha sarva aham eva vidyo vedanta krit veda vid eva cha ham. I'm seated in everyone's heart and from me come remembrance, knowledge and forgetfulness. By all the Vedas I am to be known. Indeed, I am the Kumpala of the Vedanta and I know of the Vedas. So in other words, if you study all this thing and not come to the conclusion of understanding Krishna, then you have actually wasted your time. You follow? If you studied everything and don't come to the conclusion of being Krishna conscious, then it is explained here. सप्त ब्राह्मणे निष्णन्तो न निष्णायत परः यदि श्रमस तस्य श्रमफलो य अदुनेन एव रक्षति. I want to read.
If through meticulous study of one becomes expert in reading the Vedic literature, but makes no endeavor to fix one's mind on the Supreme Personality of Godhead, then one's endeavor is certainly like that of a man who works very hard to take care of a cow that gives no milk. In other words, the fruit of one's labor study of Vedic knowledge will simply be the labor itself. There will be no other tangible result.
So this is the conclusion. You have to become Krishna conscious. Otherwise, what's the point? It's like this.
My dear Uddhava, that man is certainly most miserable who takes care of a cow that gives no milk, an unchaste wife, a body totally dependent on others, useless children, or wealth not utilized for the right purpose. Similarly, one who studies Vedic knowledge devoid of my glories is also most miserable.
So if you don't come to this point, then all your studies is a waste of time.
My dear Uddhava, An intelligent person should never take to literatures that do not contain description of my activities, which purify the whole universe. Indeed, I create, maintain, and annihilate the entire material manifestation. Among all my pastime incarnations, the most beloved are Krishna and Balaram. Any so-called knowledge that does not recognize these activities of mine is simply barren and is not acceptable to those who are actually intelligent.
So this is the point, you know. It's also, of course, stated here in the Srimad Bhagavatam.
The supreme occupation, dharma, for all humanity is that by which men can attain to loving devotional service onto the transcendental Lord. Such devotional service must be unmotivated and uninterrupted to completely satisfy the self.
So this is the supreme dharma. Param, what is that Sanskrit? Paro dharma, para dharma, topmost religious activity is to loving devotional service unto the transcendental Lord. Such devotional service must be unmotivated, uninterrupted to completely satisfy the self. So if you're doing real dharma, that means it comes to only one thing. Dharmam svanustitaha pumsham vikshvakshena katashriya no padayat yadiratim shramam eva ekevalam.
The occupational activities a man performs according to his own position are only so much useless labor if they do not provoke attraction for the message of the personality of Godhead.
So any dharma that does not bring you closer to Krishna, make you get attracted to Krishna, then it is simply a waste of time. Yes? Can I read the purport?
There are different occupational activities in terms of man's different conceptions of life. To the gross materialist, who cannot see anything beyond the gross material body, there is nothing beyond the senses. Therefore, his occupational activities are limited to concentrated and extended selfishness. Concentrated selfishness centers on the personal body. This is generally seen amongst the lower animals. Extended selfishness is manifested in human society and the centers of centers on the family, society, community, nation, and world with a view to gross bodily comfort. Above these gross materials are the mental speculators who hover aloft in the material, in the mental sphere, in the mental spheres, and their occupational duties involve making poetry and philosophy or propagating some ism with the same aim of selfishness limited to the body and the mind. But above the body and mind is the dormant spiritual soul, whose absence from the body makes the whole range of bodily and mental selfishness completely null and void. But less intelligent people have no information of the needs of the spirit soul, because foolish people have no information of the soul and how it is beyond the purview of the body and mind. They are not satisfied in the performance of their occupational duties. The question of the satisfaction of the self is raised herein. The self is beyond the gross body and the subtle mind. He is the potent active principle of the body and mind. Without knowing the need of the dormant soul, one cannot be happy simply with emolument of the body and mind. The body and the mind are but superfluous outer coverings of the spirit soul. The spirit soul's needs must be fulfilled. Simply by cleansing the cage of the bird, one does not satisfy the bird. One must actually know the needs of the bird himself. The need of the spirit soul is that he wants to get out of the limited sphere of material bondage and fulfill his desire to complete freedom. For complete freedom, he wants to get out of the covered walls of the greater universe. He wants to see the free light of and the spirit. That complete freedom is achieved when he meets the complete spirit, the personality of Godhead. There is a dormant affection for God within everyone. Spiritual existence is manifested through the gross body and mind in the form of perverted affection for the gross and subtle matter. Therefore, we have to engage ourselves in occupational engagements that will evoke our devotional consciousness. This is possible only by hearing and chanting the divine activities of the Supreme Lord. And any occupational activity which does not help one to achieve attachment for hearing and chanting the transcendental message of Godhead is said herein to be simply waste of time. This is because other occupational duties, whatever ism they may belong to, cannot give liberation to the soul. Even the activities of the salvations are considered to be useless because of their failures to pick up the fountainhead of all liberties. The gross materialist can practically see that his material gain is limited to time and space, either in this world or in the other. Even if he goes up to the Swargaloka, he will find no permanent abode for his hankering soul. The hankering soul must be satisfied by the perfect scientific process of perfect devotional service.
So you see here that unless we take up to this process of devotional service, particularly to Krishna, then anything we are doing, it falls short. You know? So this is shown in this part here that is the best example of this is Vyasadev. He wrote the Vedas, he explained the impersonal aspect, he wrote the Mahabharata, and yet still he was feeling disturbed in his heart, you know. So Narada, then he approached Narada Muni and said, what is that? I am not satisfied in my heart. What is wrong? See, he can explain here, you see here, Vyasadeva, the incarnation of God, the literal incarnation of God, you know, he himself, you see, says, Vyasa Vacha. Can someone else want to read?
Yes, Prabhu. Sri Vyasadev said, all of you have said about me is perfectly correct. Despite all this, I am not pacified. I therefore question you about the root cause of my dissatisfaction. For you are a man of unlimited knowledge due to your being the offspring of one, Brahma, who is self-born without mundane father and mother.
So this is referring to Vyasadeva talking to his guru Narada Muni. See, although I have written all these books, I am not happy. So this is how one should go and find out if they are not having, they are having some disturbance in their heart. They should go to their spiritual master and submissively inquire. So this is real religious principle to approach guru, you know. So you can see here, you can read the purport.
Yes. In the material world, everyone is engrossed with the idea of identifying the body or the mind with the self. As such, all knowledge disseminated in the material world is related either with the body or with the mind. And that is the root cause of all despondencies. This is not always detected, even though one may be the greatest erudite scholar in materialistic knowledge. It is good, therefore, to approach a personality like Narad to solve the root cause of all despondencies. Why Narad should be approached is explained below. My Lord, everything that is mysterious is known to you because you worship the creator and destroyer of the material world and maintainer of the spiritual world, the original personality of Godhead, who is transcendental to the three modes of material nature.
So unless a person has connection with God, he cannot clear your doubts. See? So Vyasadeva is speaking about Narada Muni.
Like the sun, your goodness can travel everywhere in the three worlds, and like the air, you can penetrate the internal region of everyone. As such, you are as good as the all-pervasive super soul. Please, therefore, find out the deficiency in me, despite my being absorbed in transcendence under disciplinary regulations and vows.
So you see how the greatest author of Dharma, I mean, who is the bigger author than Vyasadeva on the subject matter of Dharma, correct? Yes? So then you see what Narada is saying.
See, Narada said, you have hardly broadcast the sublime and spotless glories of the personality of Godhead. That philosophy which does not satisfy the transcendental senses of the Lord is considered worthless.
This is the point. Although he spoke the Vedas, he spoke the Upanishad, he spoke the Mahabharata, so many things, Puranas, but it did not actually broadcast the sublime and spotless glories of Krishna. Yes? Sanskrit here, you see. Bhagavato Amalam. This is referring to Krishna. See the word here. Yatha dharma adhayas cha artha. We're talking about dharma today. Can you read?
Yes. Although, great sage, you have very broadly described the four principles beginning with religious performances, you have not described to such an extent the glories of the Supreme Personality, Vasudev.
You see, although he spoke at length, but he did not speak about Krishna.
Those words which do not describe the glories of the Lord, who alone can sanctify the atmosphere of the whole universe, are considered by saintly persons to be like unto a place of pilgrimage for crows. Since the all-perfect persons are inhabitants of the transcendental abode, they do not derive any pleasure there.
See, this is the thing. We all are interested in many things not concerning Krishna. And they are considered as places, pleasure for the crows.
On the other hand, that literature which is full of descriptions of the transcendental glories of the name, fame, forms, pastimes, etc. of the unlimited Supreme Lord is a different creation, full of transcendental words directed toward bringing about a revolution in the impious lives of this world's misdirected civilization. Such transcendental literatures, even though imperfectly composed, are heard, sung and accepted by purified men who are thoroughly honest.
So this is the idea, you know, we have to come to this point. Until we come to Krishna, then we are practicing practically irreligion or cheating religion.
Knowledge of self-realization, even though free from all material affinity, does not look well if devoid of a conception of the infallible God. What then is the use of fruitive activities which are naturally painful from the very beginning and transient by nature, if they are not utilized for the devotional service of the Lord?
So material knowledge is useless. Material knowledge is useless. You know?
Sri Sanatan Goswami. Shall I read, Prabhu?
Yeah, you can read.
Sri Sanatan Goswami used to discuss Srimad Bhagavatam in an assembly of 20 or 30 learned Brahman scholars. Purport. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur gives the following commentary on the words Bhagavat Vichar, as confirmed in the Mundaka Upanishad 114-5. There are two kinds of educational system. Dve vidhe viditve iti hasma yad brahma vidho vidan vadanti para chaiva paracha tatra para Rigaveda, Yajurveda, Samaveda, Atharveda, Shiksha Kalpo, Vyakarana, Niruktam Chando, Jyotisim Iti, Ataha Parayaya, Tad Aksharam, Abhigamyate. There are two kinds of educational system. One deals with transcendental knowledge, Paravidya, and the other with material knowledge, Aparavidya. All the Vedas, the Rigveda, Yajurveda, Samved and Atharved, along with their corollaries, known as Shiksha, Kalpa, Vyakaran, Nirukta, Chanda and Jyotishi, belong to the inferior system of material knowledge, Aparavidya. By Paravidya, one can understand the Akshar, Brahman or the Absolute Truth. As far as the Vedic literature is concerned, the Vedanta Sutra is accepted as the Paravidya. Srimad Bhagavatam is an explanation of that Paravidya. Those who aspire for liberation, mukti or moksha, and introduce themselves as Vedantika, are also an equal to those groups aspiring to improve religion, dharma, economic development, artha, and sense gratification, kama. Dharma, artha, kama, and moksha are called chaturvarga. They are all within the system of inferior material knowledge. Any literature giving information about the spiritual world, spiritual life, spiritual identity, and the spirit soul is called Paravidya. Srimad Bhagavatam does not have anything to do with the materialistic way of life. It gives transcendental information to educate people in the superior system of Paravidya. Sanatan Goswami was engaged in the discussing of Bhagavat Vidya, which means he discussed transcendental superior knowledge. Those who are karmis, jnanis or yogis are not actually fit to discuss Srimad Bhagavatam. Only Vaishnavas or pure devotees are fit to discuss that literature. As stated in Srimad Bhagavatam itself, although Srimad Bhagavatam is counted among the Puranas, it is called the spotless Purana because it does not discuss anything material. It is liked by transcendental Vaishnava devotees. The subject matter found in Srimad Bhagavatam is meant for Paramhansas. As it is said, Paramo Nirmat Saranam Satam Vedam, Srimad Bhagavatam 112. A Paramhansa is one who does not live in the material world and who does not envy others. In Srimad Bhagavatam, devotional service is discussed to arouse the living entity to the transcendental position of jnana, knowledge, and vairagya, renunciation. As stated in Srimad Bhagavatam 1.2.12, the seriously inquisitive student or sage, well equipped with knowledge and detachment, realizes that absolute truth by rendering devotional service in terms of what he has heard from the Vedanta Sutra. This is not sentiment. Knowledge and renunciation can be obtained through devotional service. Bhaktya Shrutagati Gahitya, that is, by arousing one's dormant devotional consciousness, Krishna consciousness. When Krishna consciousness is aroused, it relieves one from fruitive activity for economic improvement and material enjoyment. This relief is technically called Naishkarmya. And when one is relieved, he is no longer interested in working hard for sense gratification. Srimad Bhagavatam is Srila Vyasadeva's last mature contribution, and one should read and hear it in an assembly of realized souls while engaging in devotional service. At such a time, one can be liberated from all material bondage. This was the course taken by Sanatan Goswami, who retired from government service to study Srimad Bhagavatam with learned scholars.
So you see how knowledge is distinguished here. Real knowledge means Krishna consciousness. Although the Vedas, words of God in a way, but it's not very much appreciated as transcendental, right? So it says that in this dark age of Kali, when Krishna has departed, then the Srimad Bhagavatam is the only source. What is that verse?
1.3.43. 4-3.
Krishna has, you know, see that? Can you read?
This Bhagavad Puran is as brilliant as the sun, and it has arisen just after the departure of Lord Krishna to his abode, accompanied by religion, knowledge, etc. Persons who have lost their vision due to the dense darkness of ignorance in the age of Kali shall get light from this Purana. Lord Krishna has his eternal dham or abode where he eternally enjoys himself with his eternal associates and paraphernalia. And his eternal abode is a manifestation of his internal energy, whereas the material world is a manifestation of his external energy. When he descends to the material world, he displays himself with all paraphernalia in his internal potency, which is called Atma Maya. In the Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says that he descends by his own potency, Atma Maya. His form, name, fame, paraphernalia, abode, etc. are not therefore creations of matter. He descends to reclaim the fallen souls and to re-establish codes of religion which are directly enacted by him. Except for God, no one can establish the principles of religion. Either he or a suitable person empowered by him can dictate the codes of religion. Real dharma, real religion means to know God, our relation with him and our duties in relation with him, and to know ultimately our destination after leaving this material body. The conditioned souls who are entrapped by the material energy hardly know all these principles of life. Most of them are like animals engaged in eating, sleeping, fearing, and mating. They are mostly engaged in sense. Prabhu, a little bit up. They are mostly engaged in sense enjoyment under the pretension of religiosity, knowledge, or salvation. They are still more blind in the present age of quarrel or Kali Yuga. In the Kali Yuga, the population is just royal edition of the animals. They have nothing to do with spiritual knowledge or godly religious life. They are so blind that they cannot see anything beyond the needs of the body. They have no information of the spirit soul beyond the jurisdiction of the subtle mind, intelligence, or ego, but they are very much proud of their advancement in knowledge, science, and material prosperity. They can risk their lives to become a dog or a hawk just after leaving the present body, for they have completely lost sight of the ultimate aim of life. The personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, appeared before us just a little prior to the beginning of Kali Yuga, and he returned to his eternal home practically at the commencement of Kali Yuga. While he was present, he exhibited everything by his different activities. He spoke the Bhagavad Gita specifically and eradicated all pretentious principles of religiosity. And prior to his departure from this material world, he... he empowered Sri Vyasadeva through Narad to compile the messages of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And thus, both the Bhagavad Gita and the Srimad Bhagavatam are like torchbearers for the blind people of this age. In other words, if men in this age of Kali want to see the real light of life, they must take to these two books only, and their aim of life will be fulfilled. The Bhagavad Gita is the preliminary study of the Bhagavatam, and Srimad Bhagavatam is the summum bonum of life, Lord Sri Krishna personified. We must therefore accept Srimad Bhagavatam as the direct representation of Lord Krishna. One who can see Srimad Bhagavatam can see also Lord Sri Krishna in person. They are identical.
So you see how the only book that can save us is this Bhagavad Purana. There's no other book that can save us.
This scripture named Srimad Bhagavatam is the literary incarnation of God, and it is compiled by Srila Vyasadeva, the incarnation of God. It is meant for the ultimate good of all people, and it is all successful, all blissful, and all perfect. Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu declared that Srimad Bhagavatam is the spotless sound representation of all Vedic knowledge and history. Therein are selected histories of great devotees who are in direct contact with the personality of Godhead. Srimad Bhagavatam is the literary incarnation of the Lord Sri Krishna and is therefore non-different from him. Srimad Bhagavatam should be worshipped as respectfully as we worship the Lord. Therefore, we can derive the ultimate blessings of the Lord through its careful and patient studies. As God is all light, all bliss, and all perfection, so also is Srimad Bhagavatam. We can have all the transcendental light of the Supreme Brahman, Sri Krishna, from the recitation of Srimad Bhagavatam, provided it is received through the medium of the transparent spiritual master. Lord Chaitanya's private secretary, Srila Swarup Damodar Goswami, advised all intending visitors who came to see the Lord at Puri to make a self-realized to make a study of the Bhagavatam from the person Bhagavatam. The person Bhagavatam is the self-realized bona fide spiritual master. And through him only, one can understand the lessons of the Bhagavatam in order to receive the desired result. One can derive from the study of the Bhagavatam all benefits that are possible to be derived from the personal presence of the Lord. It carries with it all the transcendental blessings of Lord Sri Krishna that we can expect from his personal contact.
So many people are really, you know, understanding that Bhagavatam is the highest literature. So maybe let me read the book, you know. But here, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Swarup Damodar, secretary, is making this point that you cannot learn Bhagavatam on your own. So you have to learn Bhagavatam from the person Bhagavatam. Now what does it mean by the person Bhagavatam? Person Bhagavatam means he is actually a devotee of Krishna. Right? The person Bhagavatam is a self-realized, bona fide spiritual master. And through him only can one understand the lessons of the Bhagavatam in order to receive the desired result. You cannot try to understand Bhagavatam any other way. This is also confirmed by Lord Shiva, you know. In this verse, Aham Vetmi Sukho Veti Vyasu Veti Na Veti Va Bhaktya Bhagavatam Graham Na Buddhaya Na Cha Tikkaya.
Lord Shiva said, I may know, Sugadev Goswami, the son of Vyasadeva, may know, and Vyasadeva may know, or may not know Srimad Bhagavatam. On the whole, Srimad Bhagavatam, the spotless Purana, can be learned only through devotional service, not by material intelligence, speculative methods, or imaginary commentaries.
Purport.
Devotional service includes 9 processes, beginning with hearing, chanting, and remembering the activities of Lord Vishnu. Only one who has taken to devotional service can understand Srimad Bhagavatam, which is the spotless Purana for the transcendentalist, Paramhansa. So-called commentaries are useless for this purpose. According to the Vedic injunction, Yasya Deve Para Bhaktir Yatha Deve Tatha Guru. Shritashvatara Upanishad 6.23. All Vedic literatures maintain that Srimad Bhagavatam has to be learned from the person Bhagavat, and to understand it, one has to engage in pure devotional service. Srimad Bhagavatam cannot be understood by so-called erudite scholars or grammarians. One who has developed pure Krishna consciousness and has served the pure devotee, the spiritual master, can understand Srimad Bhagavatam. Others cannot.
So you see, devotional service is not something, you know, that you just buy the book, you get the knowledge, and that's it, you know. Unless you surrender to a devotee, it's difficult to understand this Bhagavatam. It's also confirmed by Lord Krishna himself, you know, in this verse. Is spoken by the Lord himself. Can you read?
The personality of Godhead said, "Knowledge about me as described in the scriptures is very confidential and it has to be realized in conjunction with devotional service. The necessary paraphernalia for that process is being explained by me. You may take it up carefully."
So devotional service, knowledge here about me as described in the scriptures, you can see here, very confidential, and it has to be realized in conjunction with devotional service. If someone is not doing devotional service and is just trying to get knowledge, then this thing will not work, you know. But this not work. So this is explained more in this verse. So here it is explained.
After hearing the Prabhu, the translation?
No, he purport.
The Mayavadi sannyasi is appreciating Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu inquired from him why he did not discuss Vedanta philosophy. Actually, however, the entire system of Vaishnava activities is based on Vedanta philosophy. Vaishnavas do not neglect Vedanta, but they do not care to understand Vedanta on the basis of Sharirak Bhasya commentary. Therefore, to clarify the situation, Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, with the permission of the Mayavadi sannyasi, is wanting to speak regarding the Vedanta philosophy. The Vaishnavas are by far the greatest philosophers in the world, and the greatest among them was Srila Jiva Goswami Prabhu, whose philosophy was again presented less than 400 years later by Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur Maharaj. Therefore, one must know very well that Vaishnava philosophers are not sentimentalists or cheap devotees like the Sahijas. All the Vaishnava Acharyas were vastly learned scholars who understood Vedanta philosophy fully. For unless one knows Vedanta philosophy, he cannot be an Acharya. To be accepted as an Acharya among Indian transcendentalists who follow the Vedic principles, one must become a vastly learned scholar in Vedanta philosophy, either by studying it or hearing. Bhakti develops in pursuance of Vedanta philosophy. This is stated in Srimad Bhagavatam 1-12. Tach Shraddhana Muneyo Jnana Vairagya Yuktaya Pashyanti Atmani Chatmanam Bhaktya Shruta Gati Gitaya. The words Bhaktya Shruti Gitaya in this grahit, verse are very important.
Grahitaya.
Grahitaya. In this bhaktya, verse are very important.
Bhaktya Shruta Grahitaya. In this verse are very important.
In this verse are very important. For they indicate that bhakti must be based upon the philosophy of the Upanishads and Vedanta Sutra. Srila Rupa Goswami said, Shruti Smriti Paranadi Pancharatra Vidhim Vina Ekantiki Harir Bhakti Upataiva Kalpate.
Utpateva
Kalpate. Devotional service performed without reference to the Vedas, Puranas, Pancharatras, etc. must be considered sentimentalism and it causes nothing but disturbance to society. There are different grades of Vaishnavas, Kanishtha Adhikari, Madhyam Adhikari, and Uttam Adhikari. But to be a Madhyam Adhikari preacher, one must be a learned scholar in the Vedanta Sutra and other Vedic literatures, because when Bhakti Yoga develops on the basis of Vedanta philosophy, it is factual and steady. In this connection, we may quote the translation and purport of the verse mentioned above, Srimad Bhagavatam 1.2.12. The seriously inquisitive student or sage, well equipped with knowledge and detachment, realizes that absolute truth by rendering devotional service in terms of what he has learned, of what he has heard from the Vedanta Shruti. The absolute truth is realized in full by the process of devotional service to the Lord. Vasudev, or the personality of Godhead, who is the full-fledged absolute truth. Brahman is his transcendental bodily effulgence, and Paramatma is his partial representation. As such, Brahman or Paramatma realization of the absolute truth is but a partial realization. There are four different types of human beings: the karmis, jnanis, the yogis, and the devotees. The karmis are materialistic, whereas the other three are transcendental. The first class transcendentalists are the devotees who have realized the Supreme Person. The second class transcendentalists are those who have partially realized the plenary portion of the absolute truth. And the third class transcendentalists are those who have barely realized the spiritual focus of the absolute person. As stated in Bhagavad Gita and other Vedic literatures, the supreme person is realized by devotional service, which is backed by full knowledge and detachment from material association. We have already discussed the point that devotional service is followed by knowledge and detachment from material association. As Brahman and Paramatma realization are imperfect realizations of the absolute truth, so the means of realizing Brahman and Paramatma, that is, the paths of Jnana and Yoga, are also imperfect means of realizing the absolute truth. Devotional service, which is based on the foreground of full knowledge combined with detachment from material association, and which is fixed by dint of the oral reception of the Vedanta Shruti, is the only perfect method by which the seriously inquisitive student can realize the absolute truth. Devotional service is not, therefore, meant for the less intelligent class of transcendentalists. There are three classes of devotees, namely first, second, and third class. The third class devotees, or the neophytes, who have no knowledge and are not detached from material association, but who are simply attracted by the preliminary process of worshipping the deity in the temple, are called material devotees. Material devotees are more attached to material benefit than transcendental profit. Therefore, one has to make definite progress from the position of material devotional service to the second class devotional position. In the second class position, the devotee can see four principles in the devotional line, namely the personality of Godhead, his devotees, the ignorant, and the envious. One has to raise himself at least to the stage of second class devotee and thus become eligible to know the absolute truth. A third class devotee, therefore, has to receive the instructions of the devotional service from the authoritative sources of Bhagavata. The number one Bhagavata is the established personality of devotee, and the other Bhagavata is the message of God. The third class devotee, therefore, has to go to the personality of devotee in order to learn the instructions of devotional service. Such a personality of devotee is not a professional man. Is not a professional man who earns his livelihood by the business of the Bhagavatam. Such a devotee must be a representative of Shukadeva Goswami, like Suta Goswami, and must preach the cult of devotional service for the all-around benefit of all people. A neophyte devotee has very little taste for hearing from the authorities. Such a neophyte devotee makes a show of hearing from the professional man to satisfy his senses. This sort of hearing and chanting has spoiled the whole thing. So one should be very careful about the faulty process. the holy messages of Godhead as inculcated in the Bhagavad Gita or in Srimad Bhagavatam are undoubtedly transcendental subjects. But even though they are so, such transcendental matters are not to be received from the professional man who spoils them as a serpent spoils milk simply by the touch of his tongue. A sincere devotee must, therefore, be prepared to hear the Vedic literatures like the Upanishads, Vedanta Sutra and other literatures left by the previous authorities or Goswamis for the benefit of his progress. Without hearing such literatures, one cannot make actual progress. And without hearing and following the instructions, the show of devotional service becomes worthless and therefore a sort of disturbance in the path of devotional service. Unless, therefore, devotional service is established on the principles of Shruti, Smriti, Purana and Pancharatra authorities, the make show of devotional service should at once be rejected. An unauthorized devotee should never be recognized as a pure devotee. By assimilation of such messages from the Vedic literature, one can see the all-pervading localized aspect of the personality of Godhead within his own self constantly. This is called Samadhi.
So you can see here how we should get this knowledge. If you want to get knowledge about God, then you must go only to a devotee. Otherwise, you will fall into the footstep of this cheating religion. Yes? And everything will be spoiled. Everything you learn will be spoiled. This is the problem. So what is dharma? What is adharma? Everything can be learned only by the help of a pure devotee. And you must know. You cannot say, oh, no, I don't want to go into all these things, you know. You must know what is religion, what is not religion. Right? Otherwise, you can get bewildered. Well, why have to know so many things, you know? Of course, you can just say that and chant Hare Krishna. So, vidyam cha tad vedobhyam saha avidyaya mrityum tirtva vidyaya mrityum ashnute. Can you read that, anyone?
Anybody only one who can learn.
Let others try. Anyone else in the list? So many of you here, 28 of you.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, I'll read.
Yeah, please. Who is that? So,
yeah, Ken. Only one who can learn the process of and that of transcendental knowledge side by side can transcend the influence of repeated birth and death and enjoy the full blessings of immortality.
So you must know what is the right thing and what is the wrong thing. You have to know this side by side. So how to know this? What happened? Something wrong. So therefore, we need to take shelter of the spiritual master to teach us exactly. Because we try to rely on our own knowledge. You know? We try to go to our own mental thing. Then we will be, you know, we will be completely confused, you know. Carry on reading. Hello.
Sorry. Anything expressed by the material vibrations, anything ascertained by material intelligence, and anything experienced by the material senses or comforted within the material mind is but an effect of the modes of material nature and therefore has nothing to do with the real nature of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The Supreme Lord is beyond the creation of this material world, for He is the source of the material qualities and creation. As the cause of all causes, He exists before the creation and after the creation. I wish to offer my respectful obeisance unto Him.
If you don't surrender to Him, you know, you cannot understand things with this material brain. It's not possible. Yeah, the Lord is so powerful, you know, He can bewilder you, as explained in this verse. Please read.
Let me offer my respectful obeisances unto the all-pervading Supreme Personality of Godhead, who possesses unlimited transcendental qualities, acting from within the cores of the heart of all philosophers, who propagate various views. He causes them to forget their own soul while sometimes agreeing and sometimes disagreeing among themselves. Thus, He creates within the material world a situation in which they are unable to come to a conclusion. I offer my obeisances unto Him.
So this is what will happen, you know, the Lord will just bewilder you, you know. You see, acting within the cause of the heart of all philosophers who propagate various views, He causes them to forget their own souls, while sometimes agreeing, sometimes disagreeing among themselves. Thus He creates within the material world a situation in which they are unable to come to a conclusion also. See? That's why in the Bhagavad Gita, He also said, no? Correct? This verse in the Bhagavad Gita. Yaya dharmam adharmam cha karyam cha akaryam eva cha yatatavat prajnanati buddhi sampata rajasi.
O son of Pritha, that understanding which cannot distinguish between religion and irreligion, between action that should be done and action that should not be done, is in the mode of passion.
So he cannot distinguish what is religion, what is not religion. Correct?
That understanding which considers religion to be irreligion to be religion and religion to be irreligion, under the spell of illusion and darkness, and strives always in the wrong direction, O Partha, is in the mode of ignorance.
Correct. It is the purport.
Intelligence in the mode of ignorance is always working the opposite of the way it should. It accepts religions which are not actually religions and rejects actual religion. Men in ignorance understand a great soul to be a common man and accepts a common man as a great soul. They think truth to be untruth and accepts untruth as truth. In all activities, they simply take the wrong path. Therefore, their intelligence is in the mode of ignorance.
So this is the problem, you know. They don't know what is right, what is wrong. They go to people who are crazy, who don't know. Correct? Can read this one?
The personal weapon used by Lord Krishna, the disc, is called Harichakra. the disc of Hari. This chakra is the wheel of time. It expands from the beginning of the atoms up to the time of Brahma's death, and it controls all activities. It is always revolving and spending the lives of the living entities from Lord Brahma down to an insignificant blade of grass. Thus, one changes from infancy to childhood to youth and maturity, and thus one approaches the end of life. It is impossible to check this wheel of time. This wheel is very exacting because it is the personal weapon of Supreme Personality of Godhead. Sometimes the conditioned soul, fearing the approach of death, wants to worship someone who can save him from imminent danger. Yet he does not care for the Supreme Personality of Godhead, whose weapon is the indefatigable time factor. The conditioned soul, instead takes shelter of a man-made god described in unauthorized scriptures. Such gods are like buzzards, vultures, herons and crows. Vedic scripture do not refer to them. Imminent death is like the attack of a lion, and neither vulture, buzzards, crows nor herons can save one from such an attack. One who takes shelter of unauthorized man-made gods cannot be saved from the clutches of death.
So this is another problem. You are taking care of so many babas who supposedly in their viewpoint is some religion. This is also irreligious, adharma. Yes?
The pseudo-swamis, yogis and incarnations who do not believe in Supreme Personality of Godhead are known as Pashandis. They themselves are fallen and cheated because they do not know the real path of spiritual advancement, and whoever goes to them is certainly cheated in his turn. When one is thus cheated, he sometimes takes shelter of the real followers of Vedic principles. Brahmanas are those in Krishna consciousness who teach everyone how to worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead according to the Vedic rituals. However, being unable to stick to this principle, these rascals again fall down and take shelter among Sudras, who are very expert in making arrangements for sex intelligence. Sex is very prominent among animals like monkeys, and such people who are enlivened by sex may be called descendants of monkeys.
So this is the problem? Yes?
Yes, Prabhu.
So unfortunately, look, they do not know what is real religion, what is not religion. They go to some guys, as long as he can help them do all kind of nonsense, huh? Correct? Read on.
In this way, the descendants of the monkeys intermingle with each other, and they are generally known as Sudras. Without hesitating, they live and move freely, not knowing the goal of life. They are captivated simply by seeing the faces of one another, which remind them of sense gratification. They are always engaged in material activities known as gramya karma, and they work hard for material benefit. Thus, they forget completely that one day their small lifespans will be finished and they will be degraded in the evolutionary cycle. Just as a monkey jumps from one tree to another, the conditioned soul jumps from one body to another. As the monkey is ultimately captured by the hunter and is unable to get out of captivity, the conditioned soul being captivated by momentary sex pleasure becomes attached to different types of bodies and is engaged in family life. Family life affords the conditioned soul a festival of momentary sex pleasure, and thus he is completely unable to get out of the material clutches. He in the material world, when the conditioned soul forgets his relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, does not care for Krishna consciousness, he simply engages in different types of mischievous and sinful activities. He is then subjected to the threefold miseries, and out of fear of elephant of death, he falls into the darkness found in a mountain cave.
So you see how a person who is bereft of proper Krishna consciousness, this is his product. Like now, suffering miserable conditions. Read on.
The conditioned soul suffers many miserable bodily conditions, such as being affected by severe cold and strong winds. He also suffers due to the activities of other living beings and due to natural disturbances. When he is unable to counteract them and has to remain in a miserable condition, he naturally becomes very morose because he wants to enjoy material facilities.
Today's situation, you can see, is exactly what's happening. Everybody is frustrated because they want to enjoy. We cannot enjoy. Yes?
Sometimes conditioned souls exchange money, but in due course of time, enmity arises because of cheating. Although there may be a tiny profit, the conditioned souls cease to be friends and become enemies. Sometimes having no money, the conditioned soul does not get sufficient accommodations. Sometimes he does not even have a place to sit, nor does he have the other necessities. In other words, he falls into scarcity, and at that time when he is unable to secure the necessities by fair means, he decides to seize the property of others unfairly. When he cannot get the things he wants, he simply receives insults from others and thus becomes very morose. Although people may be enemies, in order to fulfill their desires again and again, they sometimes get married. Unfortunately, these marriages do not last very long, and the people involved are separated again by divorce or other means. The path of this material world is full of material miseries, and various troubles disturb the conditioned soul. Sometimes he loses and sometimes he gains. In either case, the path is full of danger. Sometimes the conditioned soul is separated from his father by death or other circumstances, leaving him aside. He gradually becomes attached to others, such as his children. In this way, the conditioned soul is sometimes illusioned and afraid. Sometimes he cries loud out of fear. Sometimes he is happy maintaining his family, and sometimes he is overjoyed and sings melodiously. In this way, he becomes entangled and forgets his separation from the Supreme Personality of Godhead since time immemorial. Thus, he traverses the dangerous path of material existence, and on this path, he is not at all happy. Those who are self-realized simply take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in order to get out of this dangerous material existence. Without accepting the devotional path, one cannot get out of the clutches of the material existence. The conclusion is that no one can be happy in material life. One must take to Krishna consciousness.
So that this is the conclusion.
Saintly persons who are friends to all living entities have a peaceful consciousness. They have controlled their senses and minds, and they easily attain the path of liberation, the path back to Godhead. Being unfortunate and attached to the miserable material conditions, a materialistic person cannot associate with them.
So this is the problem, you know. Can read the purport.
The great saint Jada Bharat described both the miserable condition and the means to get out. The only way out of it is association with devotees, and this association is very easy. Although unfortunate, people also get to get this opportunity due to their great misfortune. They cannot take shelter of pure devotees and consequently they continuously suffer. Nonetheless, this Krishna consciousness movement insists that everyone take to this path by adopting the chanting of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. The preachers of Krishna consciousness go from door to door to inform people how they can be relieved from the miserable conditions of material life. As stated in Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Guru Krishna Prasadepaya Bhakti Ratha Beej, Madhya 19-151, by the mercy of Krishna and Guru, one can get the seed of devotional service. If one is little intelligent, he can cultivate Krishna consciousness and be freed from the miserable conditions of material life.
So this is the problem. So when you go on the path of adharma, then you get into many, many troubles. You cannot say, I will do this adharma and I will also be successful. It's not possible. Any method other than Krishna consciousness will only leave you into a lot of misery and trouble. So what is religious activity, what is not religious activity, this all must be studied with the help of Sadhu Shastra Guru. That's why Krishna says, for to have the living entity, Vyasadeva compiled the Srimad Bhagavatam. So you see, Vyasadeva, he compiled the Bhagavatam. It's now we read, no? To help the conditioned soul. See, can you read this?
The material miseries of the living entity, which are superfluous to him, can be directly mitigated by the linking process of devotional service. But the mass of people do not know this. And thus, the learned Vyasadeva compiled this Vedic literature, which is in relation to the Supreme Truth.
So Vyasadeva, he wrote the Srimad Bhagavatam, no? Only to have the conditioned souls. Correct?
Yes, Prabhu.
And that also, Krishna also said, no? To have the conditioned soul, I have given this literature. So you can see here, Krishna says, Maya Mukta Jivere Nai Swartha Krishna Gyan Kripera Jivere Kripa Kala Krishna Veda Puran. Can you read?
The conditioned soul cannot revive his Krishna consciousness by his own effort, but out of causeless mercy, Lord Krishna compiled the Vedic literature and it supplements the Puranas.
So, to get the condition, can you read the purport?
The conditioned soul is bewildered by the Lord's illusory energy, Maya. Maya's business is to keep the conditioned soul forgetful of his real relationship with Krishna. Thus, the living entity forgets his real identity as spirit soul Brahman. And instead of realizing his factual position, thinks himself the product of material energy. According to Srimad Bhagavatam 175, Yaya sammohita jiva atmanam tri gunatmakam paropi manute nartham tat kritam chabhipadyate. Due to this external energy, the living entity, although transcendental to this, to the three modes of material nature, thinks of himself as a material product and thus undergoes the reactions of material miseries. This is the descriptions of Maya's action upon the conditioned soul. Thinking himself a product of the material energy, the conditioned soul engages in the service of the material energy in so many ways. He becomes a servant of lust, anger, greed, and envy. In this way, one totally becomes a servant of illusory energy. Later, the bewildered soul becomes a servant of mental speculation, but in any case, he is simply covered by the illusory energy. Out of his causeless mercy and compassion, Krishna has compiled various Vedic literature in his incarnation as Vyasadeva. Vyasadeva is a Shaktavesa avatar of Lord Krishna. He has very kindly presented these literatures to awaken the conditioned soul to his senses. Unfortunately, the present moment, the conditioned soul are guided by demons who do not care to read the Vedic literatures. Although there is an immense treasure house of knowledge, people are engaged in reading useless literature that will give them no information on how to get out of the clutches of Maya. The purpose of the Vedic literature is explained in the following verses. The forgetful conditioned soul is educated by Krishna through the Vedic literatures, the realized spiritual master and the super soul. Through these, he can understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead as he is, and he can understand that Lord Krishna is the eternal master and deliverer from the clutches of Maya. In this way, one can acquire real knowledge of his conditioned life and can come to understand how to attain liberation.
So this is the conclusion, you know, because Krishna has given this Veda Puran and is taught by the Acharyas. But nowadays it is says here, nobody is interested in reading and hearing them. Unfortunately, at the present moment, the conditioned souls are guided by demons who do not care to read the Vedic literature. And they don't want people to read it. Yes? You see how unfortunate. Even in our society also, they don't want people to read these Prabhupada books. They are putting all kind of crazy books outside there. And nobody is reading the books, so how you can get knowledge? People are engaged in reading useless literature that will give them no information how to get out of the clutches of Maya. Very unfortunate. Therefore, what is dharma? What is adharma in Kali Yuga? Adharma is becoming dharma, and real dharma is lost. All this kind of cheating religion is surfacing. Is it not?
Yes, sir.
You're very unfortunate. So try to understand. That's why the Srimad Bhagavatam has risen as brilliant as the sun to give direction to the conditioned souls who otherwise have lost their direction. Any other questions? He asked one question about dharma and adharma. Taken me 1.5 hours to explain it.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Yes.
Prabhu, I just wanted to understand the line from the verse 10:87:27. So, where it is saying that but with the words of tilt scholars, Sindhi. 10:87:27. Prabhu, from but with the words till scholars. Prabhu, my question is that I just want to understand what this verse is indicating. Is it indicating that learned scholars cannot come to the Lord with their knowledge, or is it like a general statement for the non-devotees that according to the statements of Shastras, the non-devotees are binded like animals? So whom is it basically referring to?
It's referring to the people who have the purport, you see, the personified Vedas have now set aside the erroneous philosophy of several contending schools. The Asad Upatti Vada, the six, you know, kinds of school. Vaisheshika, who presume a material source of creation. The Sat Vinasa Vada of the Nayaka caste, who deprive the liberated soul of consciousness. The Sat Gunatvat Veda Vada of the Sankhyas, who isolate the soul from all apparent quality. The Vipana Vada of the Mimamsaka, who condemn the soul to eternal involvement in mundane comments of karma. And the Vivarta Vada of the Mayavadis, who denigrate the soul's real life in this world in hallucination. Having rejected all these ideas, the personified Vedas now present the philosophy of devotional service. Paricharya Vada. Vaishnavas who accept this philosophy teach that the Jiva soul is an atomic parcel, particle of spiritual personality who possesses minute knowledge, is not independent, has no material quality, being minute, is prone to come under the control of the material energy, where he suffers the pains of material life. He can end his suffering, regain the shelter of the Supreme Lord, divine eternal energy, only by rendering devotional service to the Lord, not by engaging in fruity work, mental speculation, or any other process. Krishna says here in the Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam, Bhaktiyaham ekaha grahayaha siddhayatma priya satam bhaktihi punati mam nistraha swapakan api sambhavad. Only by practicing unalloyed devotional service with full faith in me can one obtain me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. I am naturally dear to my devotees who take me as the only goal of their loving service. By engaging in such pure devotional service, even the dog eaters can purify themselves from the contamination of their low birth. You want to read this on?
Yeah, Prabhu, I can read. Devotees of the Personality of Godhead worship Him as the shelter, niketa of everything that exists. Akhila Sattva. Moreover, these Vaishnav devotees themselves can be called Akhila Sattva Niketa in the sense that their abode and shelter is the philosophic truth of the reality Sattvam of both the material and spiritual worlds. Thus, Sripad Madhvacharya in his Vedanta Shruti Bhasya quotes the Shruti Mantra Satyam Hi Evadam Vishwam Ashrijata. He created this world as real. And the seventh canto of Srimad Bhagavatam 7.1.11 refers to the Supreme Lord as Pradhana Pumbhyam Naradeva Satyakrit, the creator of a real universe of matter and living entities. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur points out yet another more confidential meaning of Akhila Sattva Niketa, that the Supreme Lord's personal abodes are in no way killer or imperfect. And so-called Vaikuntha, the realms free of anxiety and restriction. Vaishnavs whose devotional service the Lord has kindly accepted are so sure of His protection that they no longer fear death, which becomes for them just another easy step. On the way back to their eternal home. But are only devotees of the Supreme Lord eligible for liberation from the fear of death? We are all, why are all other mystics and learned scholars disqualified? Hear the Shruti's answer. Anyone who is Vimukha, who has not turned his face towards the Lord with hopeful expectation of His mercy is bound up in illusion by the same words of the Vedas that enlighten the surrendered devotees. The Vedas themselves warn, Tasya Vak Tantir Namani Damani, Tasyedam Vacha Tantya Namabhir Damabhi Sarvam Sitam. The threads of this transcendental sound from a string of sacred names, but also a set of binding ropes. With the rope of their injunctions, the Vedas tie up this entire world leaving all beings fettered by false designations. The reality of the soul and super soul is aparoksha, perceivable, but only to one who, with transcendental vision, philosophers whose hearts are impure mistakenly presume that this truth is instead paroksha, that it can only be speculated upon and never experienced directly. The knowledge of such thinkers may help them dispel certain doubts and misconceptions about the lesser aspects of reality, but it is useless for transcending material illusion and approaching the absolute truth. As a general rule, only the devotees who faithfully render devotional service unto the Supreme Lord up to the point of complete purification receive His grace in the form of aparoksha jnana, direct realizations of His greatness and wonderful compassion. The personality of Godhead is, of course, free to award His mercy even to the undeserving, as He does when He personally kills offensive demons, but He is much less inclined to bless Mayavadis and other atheistic philosophers. One should not think, however, that the devotees of Vishnu are ignorant, because they may not be expert in philosophic analysis and argument. The soul's perfect realization is to be gained not through His own efforts at mental speculation, but by receiving the Lord's favor. This we hear from Vedic authority, Katha Upanishad 1.2.23 and Mundak Upanishad 3.2.23. This Supreme Self cannot be reached by argumentation or by applying one's independent brain power or by studying many scriptures. Rather, He alone can achieve the Self whom the Self chooses to favor. To that person, the Self reveals His own true personal form. Elsewhere, the Shruti describes the devotee's success. Dehante Deva Param Brahma Tarakam Vyashtashte. At the time of this body's life, the sanctified soul perceives the Supreme Lord just as clearly as if seeing the stars in the sky. And in its last statement, the Shvetashvatar Upanishad 6.23 offers this encouragement to aspiring Vaishnavas. Yasadeve, unto those great souls who have implicit faith in both the Lord and the spiritual master, all the imports of Vedic knowledge are automatically revealed. In this regard, Srila Jiva Goswami cites another verses from Shvetashvatar Upanishad. The Supreme Lord is He who is referred to by the mantras of the Rig Veda, who resides in the topmost eternal sky and who elevates His saintly devotees to share that same position. One who has developed pure love for Him and realizes His uniqueness then appreciates His glories and is freed from sorrow. What further good can the Rig mantras bestow on one who knows the Supreme Lord? All who come to know Him achieve the supreme destination. To Him who is the master of all the Vedas, in whom all planets rest, who is the Lord of all known creatures, both the two-legged and the four-legged, to Him, the personality of Godhead, we offer our worship with oblations of ghee. Referring to those who desire liberation, Srila Sridhar Swami prays, let them suffer austerities, throw themselves from mountaintops, travel to holy places, study the scriptures, worship with free fire sacrifices and argue various philosophies. But without Lord Hari, they will never cross beyond death.
So you understand this?
Yeah.
So in other words, you're referring to those people who are not, you know, devotees. So here the Lord says again.
By interaction of my energies, different opinions arise. But for those who have fixed their intelligence on me and controlled their senses, differences of perception disappear, and consequently, the very cause of argument is removed.
You follow?
Yes.
Unless the whole thing is shared by the Lord. Guided by Lord, you know. A person cannot understand this, you know. Can you read on? Can you read on?
Under no circumstances can the words of persons bewildered by the illusory energy of the Lord deviate the intelligence of those who are completely surrendered souls.
You understand? So therefore, to become a devotee, that's the most important thing. Yes. That's why Krishna said, no, Mahatmanastu Mam Partha Devim Pakirti Mashritaha. Yes? What is that verse?
9:13
Bhagavad Gita, huh?
O son of Pritha, those who are not deluded, the great souls, are under the protection of the divine nature. They are fully engaged in devotional service because they know me as Supreme Personality of Godhead, original and inexhaustible.
So those who are not deluded under the protection of divine nature. So the devotee is, that's why Krishna says, I give the inspiration, I give the understanding. But he never said that to the others who are Mayavads, who are what? This demigod worshippers, the impersonalists, all this, no. No excess. Yes?
Yes, Prabhu.
So, is that clear your question?
Yes, Prabhu. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
So, okay, I guess it's getting late. Thank you so much. I thank all of you for coming online and sharing us with us transcendental knowledge. So, please, I hope you understand this is today a bit very philosophical and deep. So, maybe you can try to hear the class again and see how far we can understand. So thank you again. Hare Krishna, all glories to Srila Prabhupada.
All glories.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.